This is the Fox 5 Rev Zone Sports Show, presented by RC Willie. Your home, your way.
Good evening and welcome to the Rev Zone, coming to you from inside Taco Bell Arena in Boise, Idaho, after the Running Rebels lose a thriller in overtime to Boise State. Kevin Bolinger alongside Running Rebels head coach Marvin Menzies. I know the result is not what you wanted, but a great effort by your team here in Boise.
Yeah, you know, I told the guys, I said, listen, this is one of those games where, you know, you did enough to win it, but they just did a little bit more. Get a couple more threes, got a couple stops, got a couple calls, but they played well enough to win, and I was proud of them, and I thought we showed marked improvement from our first encounter with Boise.
Let's show everybody what happened. It was a roller coaster where the Rebels kept rallying back to keep this game going right to the very end.
State head coach Leon Rice rode a horse through campus after saying he'd do that if they sold out Taco Bell Arena for the UNLV game. They did, and he did, and this game had plenty of giddy up in it. The big man getting lots of touches early for UNLV. Brandon McCoy with the baseline jumper, and he gets the bounce. JoJo Morey beats Shakur Justin in the lane, and McCoy with the sweet dish to Justin for the slam. Watch the pick and roll between Justin and Morey as JoJo feeds and Justin finishes. Amari Hardy had a strong first half. The pull-up jumper to beat the shot clock, and the triple. Then attacking the rim for the finger roll in the lane. But Boise used the long ball to stay right with the Rebels. Marcus Dickinson for three as this was tight. Mooring with the bounce pass to McCoy for the dunk. And McCoy in the lane for two more. Late in the first half, the set play. Keep your eye on Kris Clyburn cutting on the baseline. He gets the rock in the bucket. UNLV led 41-40 at the break. The Rebs got a quick start in the second half. The Boise inbounds pass stolen by Justin over to Jordy Johnson, who goes the length of the court for the lay-in. Justinian Jessup started hitting up for the Broncos, hitting three triples in a two-minute span. McCoy would answer back with a 17-footer, and the defense with the big block. But this is where Boise would go on a 14-0 run, mostly on threes, and this turnover that led to another triple by Jessup as the Bronco lead was built to 12. UNLV dug in. Off the Morey miss, McCoy is there. He gets the hoop in the arm. Then Hardy with the drive and dish to Justin. He throws it down. The long rebound to Johnson, ahead to Clyburn for the flush. Boise would have an 8-point lead with 2.5 to go. Johnson goes coast to coast for the bucket and the bump. And this basket in the lane would cut it to 3 with just 47 ticks left. Under 30 to go. It's Justin with the 3, and he nails it. Chandler Hutchison, last second shot is no good, and we were headed to overtime, tied at 82. Boise raced out to a 6-point lead thanks to this inside hoop from Christian Sengfelder, and UNLV began to chip away again. The lob into McCoy for the lay-in. McCoy with the turnaround. 25 to go, UNLV down 4, and it's the big man dialing up long distance. That would cut it to 1. After Jessup hit one of two free throws with 6 seconds left, last chance for UNLV down 2. It's Johnson getting to the rim. The reverse won't go. McCoy's tip-in won't go. And it's heartbreak in Boise as the Running Rebels fall short and lose 93-91.
I think we made a really big step today. You know, unfortunately, we didn't get the W, but like I feel like the sky's the limit for us. You know, we still in the running for, you know, conference tournament, and you know, we just gonna take it one day at a four, go back to the gym, and work on what we messed up on, and just, you know, come back the next game and just try to play even harder.
So let's begin with that last play there in overtime, and We've seen it before. Obviously, you want to get up the floor in a hurry with your point guard. Cut a really good look from Jordy Johnson.
Yeah, it was he was supposed to get a little brush screen in the backcourt, and then we were gonna just get him downhill. And if he had a drive and dish opportunity, which is hard to get because he's so quick down the floor, but then we would have gone for that. Otherwise, you know, you want to just get him to the rim. And he got right to the rim. And he took it up to the other side with a reverse layup. And as you saw, it rimmed out. And Brandon was still there with an opportunity, but that one rimmed out. So this wasn't meant to be tonight.
Twice your team fought back from late deficits, first to force overtime and then to get that final shot. I think that's a marked improvement with this team, that they just kind of put themselves back in position to win this game.
Well, they fought. They fought and they scrapped and they clawed and they did everything they could do to put themselves in a position to win, or at least get it into another overtime. And it just fell a little short. So you gotta, yeah, commend the fellas for their fight. For their heart and their grit, but we got to shore up some details, and I thought there were some things that we could have done a little bit better down the stretch. You know, we got to take care of the ball a little bit better. We had a couple of turnovers here, and then it's hard to defend without fouling when, you know, the whistle's going to go the way the whistle's going to go. So sometimes it goes your way and sometimes it doesn't, and you got to fight through that as well. And I thought we could have had an opportunity to win it had we got that last shot down. I think our momentum was still very good going into the overtime.
One thing that might be overlooked but shouldn't be overlooked is the way you guys played Chandler Hutchison tonight, because you really shut him down for a good part of the game, especially in the second half where we only had 2 points until very late in the game. What adjustments did you guys make that made it so successful?
Well, we threw a variety of defensives at him, and our guys were ready to do a better job, because he was so brilliant against us last time. So they played with a little more urgency in how we guarded him, and I think that it boded well for us, except for the free throw line. He ended up getting to the free throw line. I think he had 8 free throws, and but he was 6 for 18 from the field, and you can't ask for a better line going against a, you know, conference MVP caliber guy.
Well, on Wednesday night, the Running Rebels played San Jose State out of Thomas and Mack, and UNLV put the Spartans away down the stretch.
Some new pregame bling as UNLV unveiled some special 3D video projection mapping. It was cool, but so were the Running Rebels out of the gate as San Jose jumped out to an early lead. Noah Bauman with the three and a feed inside to Ashton Chastain for the easy bucket. Marvin Menzies called a quick timeout to get the team refocused, and it worked. The Rebels run in transition. Jordy Johnson ahead to Kris Clyburn, who flies through the lane for the lay-in. Then Brandon McCoy gets the jumper and the foul. The three-point play gave UNLV its first lead at 10-7. Jordy Johnson knocked down a triple. And watch the good ball movement over to Clyburn for another trifecta as the lead was built to 7. That's when the Spartans went on an 11-0 run. The alley-oop to Omar Berry. And Keith Fisher gets the bucket and the bop as San Jose regained the lead. Johnson's three ended the run, and the Rebels turned it around. McCoy with the turnaround jumper. The long rebound to Jordy, and he wants to run. The dish to JoJo for the lay-in. Shakur Justin with the penetration and the pass off to McCoy for the slam. And the capper of the half, a big block by Clyburn, triggering transition. Johnson on the move. He gets the hoop and the harm, all part of an 11-0 UNLV run. And the Rebels went into the locker room with a 39-34 halftime lead. They picked right back up in the second half. Justin with the jumper from the free throw line. McCoy gets two in the tap for a three-point play. Travell Beck with the tip in. And McCoy again in the lane as the lead was built back to 8. Ryan Wellage kept San Jose in the game single-handedly. The runner would go. Then the triple to cut it to 3 with just 10 minutes left. At this point, the Rebels took control of the game. JoJo with the steal. He heads the other way and gets the reverse lay-in. Beck works for the inside bucket. Justin goes reverse for the layup. And then off the missed free throw, McCoy with the rebound and the power move. He throws it down. The exclamation point coming from Justin. The steal, and he heads the other way for the flush. He had 10 points and 9 rebounds. McCoy had 22 and 17 as UNLV picks up a nice home win, 76-67.
When you play them the second time, you got to bring it 10 times harder. You got to, you know, come with a new move. And I feel like everybody handled it really well.
Kris blocks shots a lot. But if you see something like that in the game, you know, he's giving a lot of effort. It's gonna rub off on you, and just, you know, you're gonna wanna reciprocate.
Something that we saw in this game was you were able to put this team away. In San Jose, it was a little more of a struggle with that.
You know, that team, I think they almost had a New Mexico beat tonight. Again, another, you know, team that they're scrappy, you know, and they keep coming at you. And thank goodness we're playing better basketball. So we were able to weather their storms a little bit. And I thought down the stretch we managed the clock a lot better in winning time. And we did the necessary things to sustain a lead strategically, you know, where we ran clock and we got to the free throw line. And we stayed connected and made the right plays.
Well, time for us to take our first break. But when we come back, we're going to look ahead to this week where they've got another tough road game ahead on Wednesday night in Reno and then a home game against Wyoming on Saturday night. The Red Zone back in just 2 minutes. Stay with us.
You're watching the Fox 5 Red Zone Sports Show presented by RC Willie. Your home, your way.
It is going to be a wild road in the Mountain West down the stretch, and the Running Rebels are getting ready to get their first look at conference-leading Reno this Wednesday night.
Wednesday night in Reno, the rivalry is renewed as the battle for the Silver State begins. The Running Rebels play UNR and will have a tall task at hand. The Wolfpack have loads of talent, led by NC State transfers, twins Caleb and Cody Martin, and the always dangerous Jordan Caroline, whose motor runs fast and has the ability to dictate games.
I try to have an impact on multiple ways in the game, and I just try to bring like as much intensity and much passion as I can, so I think that's pretty much a really high impact overall.
The Wolfpack have won 16 straight at home. That's too shy of a school record. UNLV, of course, would love to end that streak, but they'll face a hyped-up crowd that has bought into the rivalry, even on the basketball court.
On campus, there's a buzz. In the community, there's a buzz. And it is meaningful in Northern Nevada, that game. And so we know it, the players know it, and you can feel the electricity in the arena as well.
Saturday, Wyoming comes to the Thomas and Mack for the only regular season meeting between the two teams. The Cowboys have been playing teams tough and winning a lot of games, proving they're going to be a factor in the conference this season. Leading scorer Hayden Dalton is surrounded by strong players, including Justin James and Lewis Adams. Dalton says Wyoming gives teams fits because of their versatility.
They got to choose what they're going to take away, you know. Shoot our threes. If not, we have guys that can go to the rim. I think we just have a good balance of a bunch of different guys who can do everything. So it's just a tough matchup.
Head coach Alan Edwards is a longtime friend of Marvin Menzies and is admiring watching the UNLV program rebuild from afar, but he's ready to battle.
He inherited a tough situation. And just with the tradition of the program, of in that process of getting it back to where it is, I don't know if there was a better guy out there to do it, and just believing in what he's doing. I appreciate, you know, what Marvin's doing, but at the end of the day, what I love about just being in this conference, like chess, you know, he has to make a move and I have to counter.
Two tough games, each with importance, one to topple the first place team, the other giving a chance to move up in the standings and gain the tiebreaker. This is a big week.
On paper, you look at this game and this is a matchup problem. They've got some depth and some quality, but they have some guys that UNLV has traditionally had a tough time matching up with over the last couple
years. I'm telling you, they are they're a really good team, and they're playing very good basketball from both sides of the ball. They're defending like crazy. They're able to switch and do a lot because of their versatility and their common size, you know, amongst guys. Even their point guard is long and athletic, and Lindsay, and they have just some really good players, you know. And, you know, Coach Muss is doing a good job of getting them to play hard and winning close games. And that's what it takes to win the regular season. And they're headed that way unless somebody can derail them.
Do you play up the rivalry aspect going into this? Because most of these guys on your team obviously are not from the state of Nevada. It's very important to the fans, but they might not be really knowing exactly right. how much this means.
Well, yeah, I've decided to educate our guys a little bit more. You can't assume that they're going to play a little bit harder, or they're going to bring a little more energy or grit or whatever, just because it's Reno. You know, you have to educate them, especially the guys that didn't grow up around here and on the West Coast and don't understand the true rivalry. So we do teach and educate the guys. And again, it's at the end of the day, it's the players got to go out and go to war, and I'm sure it'll be an exciting game.
Saturday night is Wyoming coming to the Thomas & Mack, the only time you face them. One thing that's been done under Coach Edwards is they've kept that stifling defense, but they've also picked up the transition pace, and that makes right. it tough with an inside-out type team to get back and defend. That's going to be a key on Saturday.
Yeah, I think Saturday's game will be – they'll be desperate. We'll be desperate. It's coming down to the wire in terms of jockeying for position in conference. So I think the games will be a little bit more important when it comes to seeding. And I think everybody's going to, you know, bring a little bit more spirit, a little bit more energy. It'll be good to have that game at home.
Well, we're going to take another timeout. When we come back, we're going to have a feature for you on Kris Clyburn. Back in 2 minutes.
You're watching the Fox 5 Rev Zone Sports Show, presented by RC Willie, your home, your way.
As we give you a closer look at the Running Rebel players so you can get to know them throughout the year, we want to reintroduce you to Kris Clyburn in his second year with UNLV.
Clyburn is a player who might not jump out at fans on a team with high-flying performers, but it's the little things that don't show up in stat sheets that keep him on the floor and help the Running Rebels win. It starts with energy.
Well, basically, I'm just a guy that can do all the things, little things, and bring intensity, bring energy, get stops, get rebounds, score. Got all the intangibles.
Clyburn was the first player to sign with Marvin Menzies in a time UNLV needed bodies and some quality players to fill out a roster after a coaching turnover late in the recruiting season. He ended up leading last year's team in rebounds, despite not being the widest body on the floor by a long shot.
It's natural instinct. My dad used to teach it all the time. That's all he really talked about was rebounding. Like, you might not score, yeah, do all these other things, but you could always go rebound, and that's one thing he drew home when I was younger.
He says the team's struggles last year while rebuilding has made him a better player.
Staying confident, staying like true to the game, like trusting the process, believing in what the coaches are telling us. And last year we were trying so hard to win, and we weren't really focusing on what the coach was trying to preach to us.
Basketball is in the Clyburn bloodlines. His oldest brother, Will, played at Iowa State and professionally overseas. That's made an impression.
In the summertime, we played each other a lot. You know, we kicked it a lot. We played each other one-on-one. We got in the gym a lot together. And growing up, I watched them a lot.
Clyburn is a quiet guy, and the coaches have been working with him to be more vocal.
Yeah, always. He's always on me. He makes sure I'm talking during the drills, make sure I'm talking off court, on the court.
Production on the court and wins speak the loudest. And Clyburn is hoping to get the MAC filled for conference games.
It'd be great to see that support improve throughout this year, but as long as they're there, we're rocking with them.
So the one thing we always talk about with Kris Clyburn is he does do a lot of things that don't show up on stat sheets.
Right.
Very valuable to have on the floor at times.
Yeah, you know, his versatility is good for us. You know, we get some more consistent play out of him, which is going to be – much, much needed consistent play during the latter part of conference and into the conference tournament. He's a secret weapon for us because he's the guy that once he gets going a little bit, he can, you know, he can rebound, he can get you assists, he can really defend. And those are the things that those stats don't always shine bright because they're not points, but they definitely help you win games.
One final break for us when we come back. Final thoughts from Coach Menzies on the Running Rebel Plays of the Week. Back in 2 minutes.
You're watching the Fox 5 Rev Zone Sports Show, presented by RC Willie, your home, your way.
All right, Coach, Leon Rice rides a horse on campus yesterday. Have you ever been on a horse before?
I have. I enjoyed it. I would do it for fun, not just for a sellout, but I'm glad they were able to get him on a horse, so good for him.
Time for us to ride off into the sunset. Thanks for joining us inside the Rev Zone. We leave you with the Running Rebel Plays of the Week. Good night.
Zone Sports Show was presented by RC Willie, your home, your